watching, and thank you for being here for this this evening's performance of God's Trombones. Our performance this evening is going to be a little different than our usual concert format in that the readings of the poetry by James Weldon Johnson will be interspersed with the choral pieces, and I'd like to ask that we hold our applause until the very end of the concert so that the performance aspect, sort of the grand arc of the performance piece, can be maintained. I've been wanting to do this program since the founding of the Chamber Singers a couple of years ago, and it's finally happened, and it's very exciting for me that this evening one of our narrators is an alumna of the Chamber Singers. Tiara Phillips is now at Saginaw Valley State University, where she is studying voice performance with Dr. Rachel Andrews, who is a previous, my predecessor here at Washtenaw Community College. And so Tiara will be reading, as well as Armond Wilson, who is a current member of the Chamber Singers. And so can we welcome Tiara to the podium at this time, and Armond.
Bow our hearts beneath our knees and our knees in some lonesome valley. We come this morning like empty pitchers to a full fountain, with no merits of our own. And O Lord, open up a window of heaven and lean out far over the battlements of glory and listen this morning. Lord, have mercy on proud and dying sinners, sinners hanging over the mouth of hell, who seem to love their distance well. Lord, ride by this morning, mount your milk white horse, and ride this morning. And in your ride, ride by old hell, ride by the dingy gates of hell, and stop poor sinners in their headlong plunge. And now, O Lord, this man of God, who breaks the bread of life this morning, shadow him in the hollow of thy hand, and keep him out of the gunshot of the devil. Take him, Lord, this morning. Wash him with hyssop inside and out. Hang him up and drain him dry of sin. Pin his ear to the wisdom post, and make his words sledgehammers of truth, beating on the iron heart of sin. Lord God, this morning. Put his eye to the telescope of eternity, and let him look upon the paper walls of time. Lord, turpentine his imagination, but perpetual motion in his arms. Fill him full of the dynamite of thy power, anoint him all over with the oil of thy salvation, and set his tongue on fire. And now, O Lord, when I've done drunk my last cup of sorrow, when I've been called everything but a child of God, when I'm done traveling up the rough side of the mountain, oh, Mary's baby, when I start down the steep and slippery steps of death, when this old world begins to rock beneath my feet, lower me to my dusty grave in peace, to wait for that great getting up morning. Amen.
Oh. And God stepped out in space. And he looked around and he said, I'm lonely. I'll make me a world. And as far as the eye of God can see, darkness covered everything. Blacker than 100 midnights down in a sight-free swamp. Then God smiled and the light broke. And the darkness rolled up on one side and the light stood shining on the other. And God said, that's good. Then God reached out and took the light into his hand, and God rolled the light around in his hand until he made a sun. And he set the sun ablazing in the heavens, and the light that was left over from making the sun got flung among the darkness and made the stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world, and God said, that's good. Then God himself stepped down, and the sun was on his right hand, and the moon was on his left. The stars were clustered around his head, and the earth was under his feet. And God walked where he had trod, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. Then he stopped and looked and saw that the earth was hot and barren. So God stepped out over the edge of the world, and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes and the lightning flashed. He clapped his hands and the thunder rolled. And the waters above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. Then the green grass sprouted and the little red flowers blossomed. And the pine trees pointed their fingers to the sky. And the oak spread out his arms. The lakes cuddled up around the hollows of the ground. And the rivers ran down to the sea. And God smiled again. And a rainbow appeared. And it curled itself around his shoulders. Then God raised his arms and waved his hands over the seas and over the land. And he said, bring forth. And quicker than God could drop his hands, the fowl and the fishes, the beasts and the birds swam the rivers and the seas, roamed the forests and the woods, and split the air with their wings. And God said, that's good. Then God walked around, and God looked around on all that he had made. He looked at his sun, he looked at his moon, he looked at his little stars, he looked at this world and all his living things, and God said, I'm lonely still. Then God sat down on the side of the hill where he could think. By the deep, wide river, he sat down with his head in his hand. God thought and thought till he thought, I'll make me a man. Up from the bed of the river, God scooped the clay, and by the bank of the river, he kneeled down. And there, the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it into the sky, who flung the stars to the most far corners of the night, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hand, this great God, like a mammy, bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, trolling over a lump of clay till he shaped it in his own image. Then into it he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Young man, your arm's too short to box with God.
But Jesus spoke in a parable and said, a certain man had two sons. Jesus didn't give the name of the man, but his name was God Almighty. And Jesus didn't call the sons by name, but every young man everywhere is one of those two sons. And the younger son said to his father, he said, Father, divide up the property and give me my portion now. And the father, with tears in his eyes, said, Son, don't leave your father's house. But the boy was stubborn in his head and hearty in his heart. And he took his share of his father's good and went into the far-off country. There comes a time when every young man looks out from behind his father's house, longing for that far-off country. And the young man journeyed on his way, and he said to himself as he was traveling along, this sure is an easy road, nothing like the rough fowls behind my father's house.
Young man, smooth and easy is the road that leads to hell and destruction. Downgrade all the way. The further you travel, the faster you go. No need to trudge and sweat and toil. Just slip and slide and slip and slide till you hang up against hell's iron gate.
And the younger son kept traveling along till nighttime time came. And he came to a city, and the city was bright in the nighttime like day, and the streets all crowded with people. Brass bands and string bands were playing, and everywhere the young man turned, there was singing and laughing and dancing. And he stopped a passerby, he said, tell me what city this is. And the passerby laughed and said, don't you know? This is Babylon. Babylon, the great city of Babylon. Come on, my friend, and go along with me. And the young man joined the crowd.
Young man, you are never lonesome in Babylon. You can always join a crowd in Babylon. Young man, you can never be alone in Babylon. Alone with your Jesus in Babylon. You can never find a place, a lonesome place, and talk with your God in Babylon. You're always in a crowd in Babylon.
And the young man went with his newfound friend and bought himself some brand new clothes. And he spent his days in the drinking dens, swallowing the fires of hell. And he spent his nights in the gambling dens, throwing dice with the devil for his soul. And he met up with the women of Babylon. Oh, the women of Babylon. Dressed in yellow and purple and scarlet, loaded with rings and earrings and bracelets, their lips like honeycombs dripping with honey, perfumed and sweet-smelling like jasmine flowers. And the jasmine smell of the Babylon women got to his nostrils and went to his head, and he wasted his substance in rotten living. In the evening, in the black and the dark of night, with the sweet sinning women of Babylon. And they stripped him of his money, and they stripped him of his clothes, and they left him broke and ragged in the streets of Babylon. Then the young man joined another crowd, the beggars and the lepers of Babylon. And he went to feed in the swine, and he was hungrier than the hogs. And he got down on his belly in the mire and the mud and ate the husk with the hogs. And not the hog was too low to turn up his nose at the man in the mire of Babylon. Then the young man came to himself. He came to himself and said, in my father's house are many mansions. Every servant in his house has bread to eat. Every servant in his house has a place to sleep. I will arise and go to my father. And his father saw him afar off, and he ran up the road to meet him. And he put clean clothes on his back and a golden chain around his neck. He made a feast and killed a fatted calf, and he invited the neighbors in. Oh sinner, when you're mingling with the crowd in Babylon, drinking the wine of Babylon, running with the women of Babylon, you forget about God and you laugh at death. Today, you've got the strength of the bull in your neck and the strength of a bear in your arms. But some of these days, you'll have to hand-in-hand struggle with the bony death. And death is bound to win.
Young man, come away from Babylon, that hell-border city of Babylon. Leave the dancing and the gambling of Babylon, the wine and whiskey of Babylon, the hot-mouthed women of Babylon. Fall down on your knees and say in your heart, I will arise and go to my father. Shadowy place, where death waits with his pale white horses. And Death heard the summons, and he leaped onto his fastest horse. Pale as a sheet in the moonlight, up the golden street Death galloped, and the hoofs of his horse struck fire from the gold. But they didn't make no sound. Up Death rode to the great white throne, and waited for God's command. And God said, "Go down, Death. Go down to Savannah, Georgia, down to Yamacraw, and find Sister Carolyn. She's borne the burden and the heat of the day. She's labored long in my vineyard. And she's tired. She's weary. Go down, Death, and bring her to me." And Death didn't say a word, but he loosed the reins on his pale white horse, and he clamped the spurs to his bloodless sides, and out and down he rode. Through heaven's pearly gates, past suns and moons and stars, on Death rode, and the foam from his horse was like a comet in the sky. On Death rode. Leaving the lightning's flash behind, straight on down he came. While we were watching round her bed, she turned her eyes and looked away. She saw what we couldn't see. She saw old Death. She saw old Death coming like a falling star. But Death did not frighten Sister Carolyn. He looked to her like a welcome friend. And she whispered to us, "I'm going home." And she smiled and she closed her eyes. And Death took her up like a baby, and she lay in his icy arms, but she didn't feel no chill. And Death began to ride again, up beyond the evening star, out beyond the morning star, into the glittering light of glory. Onto the great white throne. And there he laid Sister Carolyn on the loving breast of Jesus. And Jesus took his own hand and he wiped away her tears. And he smoothed the furrows from her face. And the angel sang a little song. And Jesus rocked her in his arms and kept a saying, "Take your rest. Take your rest. Take your rest. Weep not. Weep not. She is not dead. She is resting in the bosom of Jesus."
Thank you.
except for the beasts eating in the fields, and except for the birds flying through the trees, the garden looked like it was deserted. And God called out to Adam. Adam, where art thou? And Adam, with Eve behind his back, came out from where he was hiding. And God said, Adam, what hast thou done? Thou hast eaten of the tree, and Adam, with his head hung down, blamed it on the woman. For after God made the first man, Adam, he breathed him to sleep. Then he took out to Adam's rib, and out of that rib he made woman, and God put the man and the woman together in the beautiful Garden of Eden, with nothing to do the whole day long but play all around in the garden. And God called Adam before him, and he said to him, listen now, Adam, of all the fruit in the garden you can eat, except for that of the tree of knowledge. For the day thou eatest of that tree, thou shalt surely die. Then pretty soon, Satan came along. Oh, Satan came along like a snake in the grass to try out his tricks on the woman. I imagine I can see old Satan now sliding up to the woman. I imagine the first word Satan said was, Eve, you surely looking good. And I imagine he brought her a present too, and if in those days they had such a thing, he would have brought her a looking glass. And even Satan got friendly, then Eve got to walking on shaky ground. Don't matter if you're friendly with Satan. And they started to talk about the garden, and Satan said, tell me, how do you like the garden? And tell me, what do you think about that fruit on that nice, tall, blooming tree standing in the middle of the garden? And he said, that's a forbidden fruit. We eat that, we surely die. And Satan laughed, devilish little laugh. And he said to the woman, God's a fool, you Eve. That's the sweetest fruit in the garden. I know you can eat that forbidden fruit. And I know that if you will, you will not die. And Eve ate the forbidden fruit, and it was red and ripe and juicy. And Eve took a little taste, and she offered it to Adam. And Adam wasn't able to refuse, so he took a bite, and they both sat down, and they ate the forbidden fruit. Back there 6,000 years ago, man first fell to woman, and Lord, is he doing the same thing today? And that's how sin got into the world. And man, as he multiplied on earth, increased in his wickedness and sin. He went on down from sin to sin, from wickedness to wickedness, murder and lust and violence, all kinds of fornication, till the earth was corrupt and rotten with flesh and an abomination in God's sight. And God was angry at the sins of man. And God got sorry that he ever made man. And God said, I will destroy him. I'll bring down judgment on him with a flood, and I'll destroy everything on the face of the earth. Man, beasts, and birds, creeping things, and he did. Everything but the fishes. But Noah was a just and righteous man. Noah walked and talked with God, and one day God said to Noah, he said, Noah, build thee an ark. Build it out of the gopher wood, build it good and strong, pitch it within and pitch it without, and build it according to the measurements that I will give to thee. Build it for you and your household, and save the seeds of life on earth. For I am going to send down the mighty flood to destroy the wicked world. And Noah commenced to work on the ark, and he worked for about 100 years. And every day the crowd came round to make fun of old man Noah. And they laughed, and they said, tell us, old man, where do you expect to sail this boat up here amongst the hills? But Noah kept on working, and every once in a while old Noah would stop. He'd lay down his hammer, and he'd lay down his saw, and he'd take up his staff in hand. And with his long white beard flying in the wind, and the gospel light gleaming from his eye, old Noah would preach God's word. Sinners, oh sinners,
Repent, for the judgment is at hand. Sinners, O sinners, repent, for the time is drawing nigh. God's wrath is gathering in the sky. God's are going to rain down rain on rain. God's are going to loosen up the bottom of the deep and drown this wicked world. Sinners, repent while there is still time for God to change his mind. Some smart young fella said, this old man's got water on the brains, and the crowd all laughed. Lord, but didn't they laugh, and they paid no mind to Noah, but kept on sinning just the same. One bright and shiny morning, not a cloud nowhere to be seen, God said to Noah, get in the ark. And Noah got in the ark, and two by two, the animals came, and a he and a she marched in. Then God said, Noah, bar the door. And Noah barred the door. And a little black spot began to spread like a bottle of ink spilling over the sky. And the thunder rolled like a rumbling drum, and the lightning jumped from pole to pole, and it rained down, rain, rain, rain. Great God, but didn't it rain? For 40 days and 40 nights, water poured down and water gushed up, and the dry land turned to sea, and the old ark, she began to rock. The old ark, she began to rock. Sinners came a running down to the ark. Sinners came a swimming all around the ark. Sinners pleaded and sinners prayed. Sinners wept and sinners wailed, but Noah done barred the door. And the trees and the hills and the mountaintops slipped underneath the water, and the old ark sailed the lonely sea. For 12 long months she sailed that sea, a sea without a shore. Then the waters began to settle down, and the ark touched the bottom of the tallest peak of the mountain. They drove that ark down to the bottom, and Noah got an olive leaf from a dove. Noah opened the ark, and they all climbed down, the folks and the animals, two by two, down from the mountain to the valley. And Noah wept and fell on his face, and he hugged and he kissed that dry ground. And then God hung out the rainbow across the sky, and he said to Noah, that is my sign. No more will I judge the world by water the next time I rain down fire.
Elijah Rock, shout, shout. Elijah Rock coming up, Lord. Elijah Rock, shout, shout. Elijah Rock coming up, Lord.
Elijah
Rock, shout, shout. Elijah Rock coming up. Elijah Rock coming up, Lord.
Elijah Rock,
shout, shout. Elijah Rock coming up, Lord.
Elijah Rock,
shout, shout. Elijah Rock coming up, Lord. shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock, shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord.
Saying to the three disciples, sorrow is in my soul. Even unto death, tarry ye here a little while, and watch with me. Jesus, my burden, Jesus, praying in the dark of the garden of Gethsemane, saying, Father, oh Father, this bitter cup, let it pass from me. Jesus, my sorrowing Jesus, the sweat like drops of blood upon his brow, talking with his Father, while the three disciples slept, saying, Father, oh Father, not as I will, but let thy will be done. Oh, look at black-hearted Judas, sneaking through the dark of the garden, leading his crucified mob. Oh God, strike him down. Why don't you strike him down before he plants his traitor's kiss upon my Jesus' cheek? And they take my blameless Jesus, and they drag him to the governor, to the mighty Roman governor, great Pilate seated in his hall, great Pilate on his judgment seat, said, in this man I find no fault. I find no fault in him. And Pilate washed his hands. But they cried out, saying, crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him! His blood be on our heads. And they beat my loving Jesus. And they spit on my precious Jesus. They dressed him up in a purple robe. They put a crown of thorns upon his head. And they pressed it down. And they pressed it down. And they mocked my sweet King Jesus. Up Golgotha's rugged road, I see my Jesus go. I see him sink beneath the load. I see my drooping Jesus sink. And then they laid hold on Simon. Black Simon, yes, Black Simon. They put the cross on Simon, and Simon wore the cross. On Calvary, they crucified my Jesus. They nailed him to the cruel tree, and the hammer, and the hammer rang through Jerusalem's streets. The hammer rang through Jerusalem's streets. Jesus, my lamb-like Jesus, shivering as the nails go through his hands. Jesus, my lamb-like Jesus, shivering as the nails go through his feet. Jesus, my darling Jesus, groaning as the Roman spear plunged in his side. Jesus, my darling Jesus, groaning as the blood came spurting from his wound. Oh, look how they've done my Jesus. Mary, weeping Mary, sees her poor little Jesus on the cross. Mary, weeping Mary, sees her sweet baby Jesus on the cruel tree, hanging between two thieves. And Jesus, my lonesome Jesus, called out once more to his Father, saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And he drooped his head and died. And the veil of the temple was split in two, and the midday sun refused to shine. The thunder rumbled and the lightning wrote an unknown language in the sky. What a day, Lord, what a day when my blessed Jesus died. Oh, I tremble. Yes, I tremble. It causes me to tremble when I think of how Jesus died. Died on the steeps of Calvary. How Jesus died for sinners. Sinners like you and me.
Oh.
And God called out to Moses from the burning bush, and he said, in a small voice, he said, Moses, Moses. And Moses listened, and he answered and said, Lord, here am I.
And the voice in the bush said, Moses, draw not nigh, take off your shoes, for you are standing on holy ground. And Moses stopped where he stood, and Moses took off his shoes, and Moses looked at the burning bush when he heard the voice, but he saw no man.
Then God again spoke to Moses, and he spoke in a voice of thunder, I am the Lord God Almighty. I am the God of thy fathers. I am the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. And Moses hid his face.
And God said to Moses, I've seen the awful suffering of my people down in Egypt. I've watched their hard oppressors, their overseers and drivers. Then the groans of my people have filled my ears, and I can't stand it no longer. So I'm come down to deliver them out of the land of Egypt, and I will bring them out of that land and into the land of Canaan. Therefore, Moses, go down into Egypt and tell old Pharaoh to let my people go.
And Moses said, Lord, who am I to make a speech before Pharaoh? For Lord, you know I'm slow of tongue. But God said, I will be thy mouth, and I will be thy tongue. Therefore, Moses, go down yonder into Egypt land, and tell old Pharaoh to let my people go. And Moses, with his rod in hand, went down and said to Pharaoh, thus say the Lord God of Israel, let my people go.
And Pharaoh looked at Moses. He stopped still, and he looked at Moses. And he said to Moses, who is this Lord? I know all the gods of Egypt, but I know no God of Israel. So go back, Moses, and tell your God, I will not let these people go.
Poor old Pharaoh, he knew all the knowledge of Egypt, yet he never knew the one and living God. Poor old Pharaoh got all the power of Egypt, and he's going to try to test his strength with the might of the great Jehovah, with the might of the Lord of the host, the Lord mighty in battle, the God sitting on high in his heavens, laughed at poor old Pharaoh.
And Pharaoh called the overseers, and Pharaoh called the drivers, and he said, put heavier burdens still on the backs of the Hebrew children. Then the people chode with Moses, and they cried out, look here, Moses, you've been to Pharaoh, but look and see what Pharaoh's done to us now. And Moses was troubled in mind.
But God said, go again, Moses, you and your brother Aaron, and say once more to Pharaoh, thus say the Lord, God of the Hebrews, let my people go. And Moses and Aaron, with rods in hand, walked many signs of the wonder.
But Pharaoh called for his magic men, and they worked wonders too. So Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he would not let God's people go.
And God rained down the plague on Egypt, plague of frog and lice and locust, plagues of blood and boils and darkness and other plagues besides. But every time God moved the plague, old Pharaoh's heart was hardened. And he would not let God's people go. And Moses was troubled in mind.
Then the Lord said, listen, Moses, the God of Israel will not be mocked. Just one more witness of my power. I'll give hard-hearted Pharaoh this very night, about midnight, I'll pass over Egypt land. In my righteous wrath, I will pass over and smite their firstborn dead.
And God that night passed over, and cries went out all over Egypt, And the Pharaoh rose in the middle of the night, and he sent in a hurry for Moses. And he said, go forth from among my people, you and all the Hebrew children, take your goods and take your flocks, and get away from the land of Egypt.
And then Moses led them out with all their goods and all their flocks, and God went on before, a guiding pillar of cloud by day, and a pillar of fire by night. And they journeyed on into the wilderness and came down to the Red Sea.
In the morning they missed the Hebrew children. 400 years they held them down in Egypt land, held them under the driver's lash, working without money and working without price. And it might have been Pharaoh's wife that said, Pharaoh, look what you've done. You let those Hebrew children go, and who's going to serve us now? Who's going to make our bricks and our mortar? Who's going to plant and plow our corn? Who's going to get up in the chill of the morning, and who's going to work in the lazy sun? Pharaoh, tell me that.
Pharaoh called his generals, and the generals called captains, and the captains called the soldiers, and they hitched up all the chariots, 600 chosen chariots of war, and 2,400 horses. And the chariots all were full of men, with swords and shields and shining spears and battle bows and arrows. And Pharaoh and his army pursued the Hebrew children to the edge of the Red Sea.
Now the children of Israel, looking back, saw Pharaoh's army coming, and they grumbled. Of the chariots was like thunder in the storm, and the whirling of the winds was like the rushing wind, and the dust from the horses made a cloud that darkened the day, and the glitter of their spears was like lightning in the night.
The children of Israel all lost faith, and the children of Israel all lost hope. Deep Red Sea in front of them and Pharaoh's host behind, and they mumbled and grumbled among themselves. Were there no graves in Egypt? And they wailed aloud to Moses and said, slavery in Egypt was better than to come to die here in this wilderness.
But Moses said, stand still and see the Lord's salvation, for the Lord God of Israel will not forsake his people. The Lord will break the chariots, the Lord will break the horsemen, he'll break great Egypt's sword and shield, the battle bows and arrows. This day he'll make proud Pharaoh know who is the God of Israel.
Moses lifted up his rod over the Red Sea, and God, with a blast of his nostrils, blew the waters apart. And the waves rolled back and stood up in a pile and left a path through the middle of the sea, dry as the sands of the desert. And the children of Israel all crossed over onto the other side.
When Pharaoh saw them crossing dry, he dashed on behind them. Well, Pharaoh got about halfway across, and God unleashed the waters, and the waves rushed back together. And Pharaoh and all his armies got lost, and all his hosts were drowned. And Moses sung, and Miriam danced, and the people shouted for joy, and God led the Hebrew children on till they reached the promised land.
Listen, listen, all you sons of Pharaoh, who do you think can hold God's people when the Lord God himself has said, let my people go?
Thank you.
In that great day, gods are going to rain down fire. Gods are going to sit in the middle of the air to judge the quick and the dead. Early one of these mornings, gods are going to call for Gabriel, that tall, bright angel Gabriel, and gods are going to say to Gabriel, blow your silver trumpet and wake the living nations. And Gabriel's going to ask him, Lord, how loud must I blow it? And God's going to tell him, Gabriel, blow it calm and easy. Then, putting one foot on the mountaintop and the other in the middle of the sea, Gabriel's going to stand and blow his horn to wake the living nations. Then God's going to say to Gabriel, once more, blow your silver trumpet and wake the nations underground. And Gabriel's going to ask him, Lord, how loud must I blow it? And God's going to tell him, Gabriel, like 7 peals of thunder. Then the tall, bright angel Gabriel will put one foot in the battlement of heaven and the other in the steps of hell and blow that silver trumpet till he shakes old hell's foundation. And I feel the earth gonna shudder, and I see the graves a-busting, and I hear a sound, a blood-chilling sound. What sound is that I hear? It's the clicking together of dry bones, bones to bones to dry bones. And I see coming out of the bursting graves and marching up the valley of the dead, the army of the dead, and the living and the dead, in the twinkling of an eye, are caught up in the middle of the air before God's judgment bar. Oh, sinner, where will you stand in that great day when gods are going to rain down fire? Oh, you gambling man, where will you stand? You whore-mongering man, where will you stand? You liars and backsliders, where will you stand in the great day when gods are going to rain down fire? And God will divide the sheep from the goats, and one on the right and the other on the left. And to them on the right, God's going to say, enter into my kingdom. And those who've come through great tribulations and washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb, they will enter in, clothed in spotless white, with starry crowns upon their heads and silver slippers on their feet and harps within their hands. And two by two they'll walk up and down the golden streets, feasting on the milk and honey, singing new songs of Zion, and chattering with angels all around the great white throne. And to them on the left, God's going to say, depart from me into everlasting darkness, down into the bottomless pit, and the wicked, like lumps of lead, will start to fall. Headlong for 7 days and nights they'll fall, plump into a big, black, red, hot mouth of hell, bleaching out of fire and brimstone, and like cries, like howling, yipping dogs, will go up with the fire and smoke from hell, but God will stop his ears. Too late, sinners, too late. Goodbye, sinners, goodbye. In hell, sinners, in hell, beyond the reach of the love of God. And I hear a voice crying, time shall be no more, time shall be no more, time shall be no more, and the sun will go out like candles in the wind, the moon will turn into dripping blood, the stars will fall like cinders, and the sea will burn like tar, and the earth shall melt away and be dissolved, and the sky will roll up like a scroll. With a wave of his hand, God will blot out time and start the wheel of eternity. Sinner, oh sinner, where will you stand in the great day when gods are going to rain down fire, fire, fire.
There's a great camp meeting.
There's a great camp meeting. Woo!
together.